The CBS Radio Mystery Theater presents... Come in. Welcome. I'm E.G. Marshall. One always admires the truth seekers. And rightly so. However, there have been times when men of good conscience have deliberately concealed the truth because they felt it would be unbearably painful. Paraphrasing the 17th century philosopher Vico, it might be said that men who do not know the truth of things try to reach certainty about them to satisfy their conscience. And yet, the discovery of truth can sometimes bring about the exact opposite effect. It satisfies everything except one's conscience.
If I understand you correctly, and I think I do, Monsieur Dubois, you're telling me that you know exactly what I'm going to find out, and that it's ugly and venomous, and therefore should be kept secret.
I say more than that, madame. I issue you a warning, and I beg you to heed it while there is still time. If you persist in this search, it will lead you inevitably to those who hold life very cheaply. So I ask you for your own sake, go home. Go home before you damage yourself irreparably.
Our mystery drama, Sleeping Dogs, was written especially for the Mystery Theater by Murray Burnett and stars Marion Seldes. It is sponsored in part by Sinoff, the Sinus Medicines, and Buick Motor Division. I'll be back shortly with Act One. Memory is the great eraser. It has a way of betraying our senses by blotting out the jagged edges of sorrow and unhappiness and leaving us with a false glow of happiness for the good old days. Although it has been proven that the good old days weren't really so good at all, many of us refuse to believe it, preferring to trust our memories. And some of us even go so far as to spend a lot of time in trying to relive the past.
Don? Don, did you see this article in tonight's paper?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you were dozing again.
No, I was sleeping.
Listen to this. Yesterday, the remaining members of that gallant underground group of World War II, Les Insurgents, had a sad reunion. The occasion was the funeral of one of their comrades, Léon Boulet, who died after a long illness, reducing the living members of that famous band to six. Les Insurgents were renowned for their daring exploits during the Nazi occupation and for being the link between a group of U.S. paratroops and the Free French forces some months prior to D-Day. Now, what do you think of that?
Léon Boulet. He was a good man, Léon.
Was he? Or was he the man who turned over Lance to the Gestapo?
Oh, please, Florence. I thought that perhaps you were beginning to forget. Please, let's not tear at this thing.
I could stop. If I once knew. Was Léon Boulet the man who betrayed Lance?
Oh, he couldn't have been.
You sound so infuriatingly certain about who it could not have been, and so eternally vague about who it really was.
I happen to know that Léon was operating in the south of France at the time Lance was dropped, and I doubt if they ever met.
But you don't happen to know who turned Lance over to the Nazis.
No, no, I don't.
I'm no longer going to accept that answer, Don.
Florence, we've been through this so many times and so uselessly. Please don't let that news item upset you.
It hasn't upset me. It's given me an idea. I'm going to Paris. Somebody there must know.
After 30 years, it's been forgotten, I'm sure. If anyone ever really did know.
I've been married to you for more than 20 years, Don. And I still can't understand your attitude about Lance's death. After all, you were both in the same outfit.
Florence, millions of people were killed in the war, and a lot of them were paratroopers.
But only one was Lance Sheldon. And he didn't have to die. He died because some coward turned him into the Germans to save his own skin. Do you think it's right that whoever that was should go unpunished?
I don't think the man went unpunished. I think Les Insurgents took care of him.
Well, then why don't you or anyone else know his name?
Because of Les Insurgents. I was there. I worked with them. They had a fierce pride in themselves and their love of France. To the public, every one of Les Insurgents was a hero. If one wasn't, no one will ever know. And that's the way they intend to keep it.
I'm just as proud of Lance and his record. He was so beautifully young, Don. So brave. I'm sorry. I'm leaving for Paris as soon as I can get on a plane.
Florence, do you believe I love you?
Oh, Don, of course.
Then listen to me when I tell you not to go, not to waste your time. Oh, how can I explain this to you? The times were... They were different then. And no, they were murderous. It wasn't only the war and the killings and the fear. It was the people. I don't want you rooting around in that garbage. It could be dangerous. You don't have the faintest idea of what you might be getting into or even where to start.
Yes, I do. I just read part of the newspaper article to you. The rest of it dealt with a priest, Father Vilmy. He's the parish priest where Léon Bollé was buried, and he used to be one of the leaders of Les Insurgents. I'm going to start with him. Father Vilmy?
Yes. Come in.
Thank you. My name is Florence Peterson. Mrs. Peterson.
Yes, madame?
I read about you in the paper in America, about Les Insurgents.
Yes, and...
This is my second marriage. My first husband was Lance Sheldon. I've come a long way to get an answer to something that's been bothering me all these years.
Well, if I can help you in any way...
I want the name of the man who betrayed my husband.
I'm sorry, Madame Peterson, but I do not have the information you seek.
Well, I find that strange, Father. You must admit, you were one of the leaders of Les Insurgents. You knew Lance. And yet, you don't know the name of the member of your group who betrayed him?
You are a good woman, Madame Peterson. I am aware of your feelings, but you are completely unaware of the way a well-organized underground works. If it is to survive, it had better see that all of its members know as little as possible about everyone else.
But you knew Lance.
I did. I had been chosen as the contact for Lance and others.
Well, can't you try to recall something that happened? Something that...
It is a long time ago, madame. It is the dead past. Let it remain dead.
Don said it would be like this.
Don?
My husband, Don Peterson, he said you'd be hiding behind some silly sense of keeping the memory of Les Insurgents bright and shiny, that you didn't care about punishing the traitor.
He's a wise man. Why didn't you heed what he said? Your first husband is dead. If you will forgive me, you are living with a memory. It is best you forget it.
You and Les Insurgents are also living with memories. If you're entitled to them, then I'm determined to have mine whole and complete, the way you want yours. Salade niçoise and black coffee is all I want. No wine, thank you.
No wine? But, madame, in Paris, that's unthinkable.
thank you. I don't want either wine or your company.
Yeah, but I think you do, madame. You are Madame Florence Peterson, are you not?
Yes, I am, but...
Paul Dubois, you left a message for me.
Oh, for you to telephone. You must forgive me, but I hardly expected you'd come here.
Such a cryptic message, madame. If you are interested in the history of Les Insurgents, call Madame Peterson at the Versailles. I say to myself, Paul, be careful. How does this lady know about you and Les Insurgents? Perhaps it would be wise to find her personally and take her by surprise. And voila, I'm here. I am no longer afraid.
What were you afraid of?
Who knows? Ghosts, madame. Evil shadows of the ugly past, a stirring of old cautions. I do not know if you would understand.
Of course I do.
You will be so kind as to tell me how you knew about me and Les Insurgents.
I read it in the newspaper. You were one of the men who attended the funeral of Léon Bourlet.
Ah, and why should that have interested you?
Before I married Donald Peterson, I was married to Lance Sheldon.
Oh. And now you come here to Paris to ask me for what?
The truth.
But you have come to precisely the wrong person. Ask anyone and he will tell you that Paul Dubois is a tremendous liar. The truth is not in
him. Please, this is important to me. Don't play the clown. You see, I know better. Don has spoken to me about you many times.
Don is a fine man. Has he not told you what you want to know about Lance?
He can't, because he doesn't know.
Not know, but Don and Lance were in the same outfit. They went through training together. Surely Don would know what a magnificent officer Lance was and how he's
made... I don't need Don, nor you, to sing Lance's praises to me. After all, I was his wife for 6 months. 6 beautiful months. What I want to know is who betrayed him.
Why now, madame, after all these years?
I want justice. I want the man who delivered him to the Nazis punished. I want to make him suffer, just as Lance must have suffered before he died.
I see. Your husband sent you?
No, he asked me not to come.
Why do you think he would make such a request?
Oh, he's been telling me for years. Let sleeping dogs lie. Don't reopen old wounds. But that's not his real reason.
No? What do you think it is?
Jealousy. I suppose we both know I'd never have married Don if Lance lived, and I think he wants me to forget.
And do you think he's wrong?
No, I think he's right. But what he doesn't understand is that I can forget much more quickly and easily if I could once be sure that the man who betrayed Lance had gotten what he deserved.
Do any of us ever get what we deserve?
Oh, Monsieur Dubois, I didn't come more than 3,000 miles to answer philosophical questions.
I understand, madame. You came for revenge.
I should think you'd be even more anxious than I to see the man who betrayed you punished.
Madame, if I were to tell you...
Excuse me. That man there, at the door. It's Father Vilmi.
Huh? Ah, nonsense. What would he be doing here?
I tell you, it is.
Yeah, well, sit here a moment. I've known Alex much longer than you. I'll see if it is he.
He's not wearing his collar. He just went out the door.
I'll be back immediately.
Well, what did he say? Where is he?
Well, I imagine where he should be, at his parish.
You're telling me that I didn't see Father Vilmi?
Madame, I searched the corridor and the lobby. Alex was not there.
Why are you lying to me? I'm sure I saw him.
Please forget what you think you saw. You want to know why Les Insurgents should not be as anxious as you to see the betrayer punished. Remember?
Yes.
Well, the answer is very simple. Now, if I were to furnish you with a statement signed by our surviving members, swearing to their knowledge of the name of the betrayer, would that satisfy you?
Would the statement include the name?
No.
Well, why not?
Because it would serve no purpose.
But that's the only reason I'm here.
Madame, Paris was a very different city under the occupation, a very different world. Values were different then.
Not mine.
Have you ever turned up a stone
And suddenly what was beautiful and verdant is ugly and venomous. And the peaceful countryside changes completely.
You're telling me that what I may find out is ugly and venomous and therefore should be kept a secret.
I'm saying more than that, Madame Peterson. I am asking you to take the statement we are willing to give you and return home. Heed my warning while there is still time. If you persist in this search, there is danger for you.
You're threatening me.
No. I am simply warning you that your search will inevitably lead you to some who held life very cheaply in those days. And they may easily revert to that old savage philosophy. I cannot be responsible for what may happen.
The Bible says, "And the truth shall set you free." But it doesn't say at what cost. Some people aren't willing to pay the price. But Florence Peterson seems willing to risk her life in order to find and punish the man who betrayed her husband. I'll be back shortly with Act Two. We've all heard perhaps too much about anti-American feeling all over the world. And some travelers return with stories about the coldness of the French to American visitors. Most Americans still find Paris a beautiful and friendly city to visit. But the reception given to Florence Peterson is really something else. Not only do the people she is seeing say, in effect, "Yankee, go home," but they are seemingly willing to force her to get out of France.
Monsieur Dubois, are you responsible for this note that was slipped under my door a few minutes ago?
Who is this?
Florence Peterson. I'm calling to tell you that I don't appreciate what you've done. I react very badly to threats.
Slowly, madame, if you please. I don't know what you're talking about.
Well, I'll read it to you. Madame, forget what you have come here for. If you are wise and concerned for your safety and sanity, you will be on a flight out of here tonight. Be wise and go. Signed, a friend of Les Insurgents.
Madame, I know nothing about this. But if you will recall, I said it was dangerous for you to stay.
That's why I telephoned you. As a member of Les Insurgents, I felt that you could possibly...
I think we should meet.
Only if you'll agree to help me. I know you can if you want to.
Let me say that I will not be antagonistic.
And you won't tell me to go home.
That must be your decision. Let us say the Café de la Paix. At 4 this afternoon.
Oh, Mr. Craig. Do come in.
Thank you, Ms. Peterson, for seeing me. My credentials to show that I'm attached to the consul here in Paris.
I checked right after you phoned.
Well, that was wise.
I can't imagine why you wanted to see me.
Well, about your, shall we say, mission here in Paris.
And how did you hear about it, Mr. Craig?
Well, that doesn't have any bearing on my reason for being here, Mrs. Peterson. You've opened the can of worms.
I thought so. I'm happy to hear you confirm it.
Don't jump to conclusions. We're not happy about what you're trying to do.
What?
Well, now, please, I'd like you to try to understand.
I'll try.
The information you seek will only, stir up a lot of trouble and cause repercussions that far outweigh any personal motives that you may have.
Mr. Craig, why should you be here to keep me quiet?
Well, I assure you, Mrs. Peterson...
What is it? Why are so many people anxious for me not to know the identity of a traitor?
Well, that's one way of looking at it.
Is there any other way?
Mrs. Peterson, whether you like it or not, the world has moved on. Some of the heroes of the resistance, and particularly Les Insurgents, have become important figures.
What you're trying to tell me in your special, diplomatic fashion is that the man who betrayed my husband is now an important figure and must be protected.
No, I never said that. You've misunderstood completely.
No, I don't think so. Mr. Craig, I don't care what happens as long as I can find the man who was responsible for my husband's death.
madame. You see, this time it is I who wait for you. Please sit down.
Thank you, Monsieur Dubois. Does this mean you are willing to help me?
Of course. Well, the more I thought about your obvious love for young Sheldon, the more I sympathized. At first, I was thinking too much of Les Insurgents and your present husband.
What do you mean?
You told me that Don Peterson, who I also know, asked you not to undertake this. And you did, anyway. Then, indeed, it is apparent how much your first marriage meant to you.
Yes, what you say is true. I can tell you, a stranger, that I loved Lance as I never could love Don. You know, it's not that Don isn't... It's just that I remember Lance as sunlight and laughter, and Don is... Oh, Mr. Dubois, I respect Don. He's been good to me. Of course, you know how we met.
No.
He was chosen to tell me of Lance's death. I remember asking him at the time whether Lance's betrayer had been punished, and I think he said something to the effect that it had been done. I really don't remember. He was very kind, gentle.
Yes?
Maybe I haven't been the wife to him that I should be, but I do try, honestly try. But Lance is there somewhere in the back of my head.
And also in your heart.
Yes, I suppose so. But I really believe that if I can satisfy myself that justice has been done, then maybe it isn't too late for me to make it up to Don.
And that is why I am here. I am prepared to help.
Then you'll give me the name.
That's not for me to decide. I must obtain permission from my comrades. If you will wait until I make a phone call, I may have some news for you. Porter Dubois here.
You have spoken with her?
I can only apologize. The identity of the man who gave Lance Sheldon away has become an idée fixe with her. I don't believe that there's any way in which she can be dissuaded.
Well, we just have to let her go ahead and try to block her at every turn.
I disagree. You must be protected at all costs. That is our prime objective. I suggest elimination.
Absolutely not.
You have not met the woman. I have. She will not rest.
There is no reason for her to be removed, and I forbid it. There must be another way.
Can you think of one, sir?
What about Alex?
Well, she started with him. She may have a reason to mistrust him.
He is still a priest. Perhaps we can get him to help you prepare some kind of a charade. Something that would satisfy her and still conceal the truth. Everyone would be happy.
That was a long call. Well, can you tell me the name?
Not at the moment, madame, but I am hopeful.
Of what?
Of getting permission from those who have yet to be contacted.
And how long will that take?
Oh, a day or two at the most. Meanwhile, you enjoy the beautiful sights of Paris, and I promise to contact you. Alex, a course of action has been suggested, one in which you can be of help.
And that is?
To give her an answer, to make her believe that her search has been successful.
Can it be done?
I think, with your help.
And what would that consist of, Paul?
Well, let's say a theatrical presentation. A recital of how angry we were when we discovered that we'd been betrayed.
And how frightened, if we must be truthful.
That too. And then we discovered the traitor, and we eliminated him. Lance Sheldon's death had been avenged by the death of the man who betrayed him, and Madame Peterson is happy.
Do we have a name for the traitor, Paul?
Any name will do. Any name in your graveyard.
No.
But it's foolproof, Alex. We'll tell her what she already half believes.
that you couldn't give her the information before. You had to get permission from all the members of the group.
I cannot use the church to buttress a lie. I will not be a party to it, Paul.
The church doesn't enter into it. We are using Alex Villemy, a former member of Les Insurgents, to protect our reputation.
Alex Villemy could have done it. Father Villemy cannot and will not.
Think of the peace that you will bring to this poor, tortured woman. I have spent time with her. She's sincere. She really must have this information.
And you, think of the poor soul lying in his grave. The soul who never committed a murder and whom I, a priest, now name as a killer. No, no, Paul. You cannot ask this of me.
I do. In the name of Les Insurgents. In the name of every one of us who fought alongside you, Alex, and who died protecting you and me, I do ask it.
And I refuse. In the name of the Lord.
Mr. Craig, if you've come here again to tell me to leave Paris, you're just
I would be just wasting my time. I know that, Mrs. Pearson. And as I told you over the phone, that's not my purpose.
But surely you're not here to help me.
Well, that's exactly why I am here. There's been a good deal of time spent at the consulate about you and your search. We're deeply concerned about your safety.
Please.
Oh, we do have a responsibility for your welfare. We must keep an eye on you here in Paris. But we ask you a favor. To give us your word that if you leave the city, you'll let us know immediately. And also tell us your destination.
Why should I do that?
Well, for your own sake. It isn't too much to ask.
All right. I don't see what harm that can do. Hello?
Madame, I have good news for you. Tomorrow, you shall have the answer you seek. You will be downstairs in front of the hotel at exactly 10 o'clock in the morning. Because we have to drive out of Paris.
Where are we going?
I cannot tell you. But what does it matter? I promise that when we are finished, there will be no more questions in your mind.
Oh, that's wonderful. Oh, but... Oh, I feel like such a fool. I've made a commitment.
I thought you were committed, madame. Finding the name of the man.
Oh, I am. I'll go with you, but I mean, I promised to inform the American consulate if I left Paris, to tell them where I'm going.
Out of the question.
But I gave Mr. Craig my word.
That is regrettable. I wish you a good day.
No. Don't hang up. Why can't you let me tell the consulate? What harm could there be in that?
Madame, you have never understood us or our motives. You have looked only at yourself. I thought by now you would have realized how jealous Les Insurgents are of their place in history, of our reputation. Because I pleaded your cause, and because the answer you seek concerns me personally, permission has been given to tell you the whole story. But it must stop there. No one else. I thought I could trust you.
All right. No. All right. I'll be downstairs at 10 o'clock, and I'll go with you, and I won't tell a soul. I give you my word.
Fools rush in, of course. But as a matter of fact, Florence Peterson is neither a fool nor an angel. Just a haunted woman driven by a need to know the answer to a question that has nagged at her and almost destroyed her life. We'll be back with the answer she receives in just a few moments. At some point in our lives, I'm sure all of us have felt that we were out of place. But I wonder how many of us have ever experienced the feeling of being out of time. That is to say, that your presence in that particular place was either too early or too late. That was exactly the feeling that Florence Peterson was experiencing as she sat beside Paul Dubois and felt him slow the pace of the speeding car.
We're almost there, madame.
Colombelle des Églises. Isn't this the town where General de Gaulle lived?
And is buried, madame.
as are some of his officers and brave men of the resistance. Right here, in this cemetery. If you please, madame.
Thank you.
Are you all right?
Yes, I think so. I just feel frightened.
Cemeteries affect some people that way. A reminder of our mortality.
I'm all right now.
Good. Here, we step off the path here. My family plot is just over there.
You're showing me a grave?
Yes, madame. A tombstone. And on that tombstone will be the name you seek.
But I thought you said this was your family.
The end of your search.
René Dubois. Born 1921. Died 1944.
My brother, madame. My brother was the traitor.
Oh, no. Oh. Oh, I'm sorry.
No, you are not. He was too young. I blame myself, but it was difficult. We had always been close, and we made a mistake. I told him about Les Insurgents and asked him if he wanted to join us. I knew, of course, what the answer would be. But I did not know that within 2 weeks he would be caught. It was too soon.
I understand. You don't have to say anymore.
No, you must hear the whole story. We knew René had been captured, but he rejoined us a week later with only a few superficial bruises and a story that he deceived the Gestapo into thinking him an innocent. Oh, I wanted to believe him. I think it was only because he was my brother that the other officers allowed themselves also to be deluded, but...
But it was possible, wasn't it?
Hardly, madame. We had seen too many prisoners who had been interrogated by the Gestapo. And then little things began to go wrong. Our plan seemed foredoomed to failure. And we knew. But still, no one said anything to me until your husband was captured. Then we knew action had to be taken. He was my brother, madame. And I executed him. Your husband and Les Insurgents were avenged. But an oath was taken, madame, an oath not to reveal this to anyone. It was something that was finished and forgotten.
I promise to forget. I will never breathe a word of this to a living soul. I understand so much now. The reason for your actions and Father Villain.
Monsieur Dubois, Monsieur Dubois. I neglected to ask you when you ordered the gravestone I put in your plot yesterday whether you desired the bill to be sent to your home or your office.
I can understand your anger, madame.
You are beneath contempt.
I warned you, madame. I told you I was a liar, not to be trusted.
A liar? What you've done to me is inhuman. What a fool I've been. You knew when you went through that utterly contrived story about your brother. I cried.
Madame, I beg you to consider. Your pride has been hurt, nothing more.
Hush.
Very well. I shall resign myself to a long, silent drive back to Paris.
Good. You can think of other ways in which to try and stop me while I try to find the truth. Because I want it now, more than ever.
Madame, I repeat the only word of truth I have spoken to you. For your own good, go home.
Dubois.
Oh, I trust you have good news and everything will
A disaster. The stonemason asked where he should send the bill just after I'd convinced her. I shall never forgive myself for not paying him at the time. It was...
Look, as it would seem, we have almost exhausted our resources.
I don't see what else we can do short of...
You will have to forget about her, obviously. I still have one avenue open to me.
I cannot think of a single possibility.
The truth.
Well, aside from the risk you run, I don't think that at this point she would believe it.
Hello?
Don. Oh, I'm so glad you're home. I know it's terribly expensive to call, but I must talk to you.
I've missed you.
I missed you, too. Honestly, more than I thought I would. I need you, Don.
Oh? What is it?
Something new has come up.
What is it?
I have to go to Munich.
Why? Why don't you take what is good advice and come on home?
Oh, Don, please. Not you. Just let me read you this note I received.
Go ahead.
Madame, if you want the answer you have been seeking so avidly, go to Munich. You will find an Heinrich Rothman listed in the telephone directory. Call him. Identify yourself as having been sent from Paris by the Fox. 30-some-odd years ago, he was Colonel Rothman, head of the SS forces in Paris. He has the answer you seek. Don, you hear me?
Yes.
Well, what should I do?
All I can say is that there was a Colonel Rothman, and if I were you, I'd call Munich before I leave Paris. If you reach him, tell him you're coming. And don't tell him why over the phone.
Frau Peterson, come in, come in. I fear the room is too warm, but in the remainder of my life, I seek warmth. How would you come to know the Fox?
My husband served with the resistance in France.
Ah. You said your name is Peterson. Your husband was not French?
My husband's name was Lance Sheldon. Captain Sheldon. And I want to know the name of the man who betrayed him. It's someone important, someone so important that no one will tell me.
Frau Peterson, are you sure you want this information?
I've come a long way to get it, Colonel Rothman.
The name of the traitor was Sheldon. Captain Lance Sheldon of the United States Army.
What? What are you saying?
Your first husband, Frau Peterson, was the man who betrayed les insurgents.
I don't believe you.
Well, believe what you want. You came to me for an answer. I give it to you. A French farmer who had been cooperating with us saw your husband's parachute descent one night. He reported it to us, and we picked up Captain Sheldon.
No.
If you do not wish me to continue, I will stop. We will talk about other things.
That can't be true. Lance would never...
Captain Sheldon quickly saw the strength of our position and the weakness of his, particularly after we introduced him to some prisoners we had interrogated. So he quickly agreed to work for us. He did fairly well, but did not, as I had hoped, get us the identity of the Fox. Although it is of no importance to me today, I believe the Fox executed Sheldon when they discovered he was our link to them. And if that is so, then there would be good reason not to tell you, no?
It just can't be. This is another of their tricks. It's just another attempt to keep me from the truth. I won't fall for it. I won't allow them or you to blacken the name of my husband. Break my heart.
Oh? You would perhaps like to see some photographs I have kept over the years.
No, they don't interest me.
Of course not. You're just another fool who does not want the truth. Who wants to believe only what she... Good day, Frau Peterson.
No. Wait. You... You do have some pictures.
Be patient. While I wheel myself over to the desk, I will show you. Here, wait. Where is it? Ah. You see, Frau Petersen, when we enlisted the spy, we tried to make sure that she would not betray us, and so we took pictures like these. Careful. They are fragile after all these years. But you see, they clearly show Captain Sheldon in uniform, shall we say, fraternizing with me and some other members of the SS. There is your husband. There is your hero. Well, what a fool. She's fainted.
Florence! Florence! Over here, this way.
Don! How did you know I'd be on that?
Dubois cabled me that you'd be on this flight.
Oh. Well, that was nice of him.
Of course. Well, now you know.
Yes, I know. Don, I can't face you. All these years. These long-wasted, bitter years. And you must have known and you couldn't tell me. Oh, I can't ever... How can I make them up to you?
No need. Remember Browning's poem? Grow old along with me.
Oh.
The best is yet to be.
Don.
For you, Florence. And for us.
Most of us treasure our illusions. Indeed, some very great writers, Eugene O'Neill being one of them, felt strongly that once stripped of them, we wouldn't find life worth living. But there must be exceptions to every rule, and particularly one would feel when the bitter loss of illusions can also give you a reason for living. And Don Peterson had just given his wife the best reason in the world, love. I'll be back shortly. Cynical among us never tire of pointing out how horrible life is. English poet A.E. Housman wrote that the two traits of man are to stand up and walk the treadmill or to lie flat, know nothing, and be still. He sums it all up by saying, "Which is worse, I know not, but I know that both are ill." I can think of a number of things that make life worth living. Things like work, and love, and storytelling. Our cast included Marion Seldes, Court Benson, Guy Sorrell, and Robert Maxwell. The entire production was under the direction of Hyman Brown. Radio Mystery Theater was sponsored in part by Allied Van Lines, Allstate Insurance Companies, and True Value Hardware Stores. This is E.G. Marshall inviting you to return to our Mystery Theater for another adventure in the macabre. Until next time, pleasant dreams.